Yeah, Commissar Binkov.
I, Commissar Binkov, present you India versus China. How would a hypothetical war between these two powers go? They share a border at several places, in dispute about most of it. Several different fronts would be likely. Numbers-wise, India is comparable to China in certain areas. Its army reserves and paramilitary are larger, though Chinese total reserves still eclipse it. But when it comes to technology and hardware, Chinese have the upper hand. Not only do they have twice as many tanks, but they are on average more capable. Situation with artillery is even worse for India, as China has an order of magnitude more self-propelled guns. Multiple rocket launchers and towed artillery numbers are also quite disproportionate. Even though the number of soldiers is comparable, Chinese army is more mechanized. A good deal of Indian infantry units use lightly armored or unarmored trucks. But most of those Chinese tank, artillery and vehicle numbers would hardly come into play, because of topography. The Himalayan mountain range is simply too much for either side to cross with anything larger than battalions of light infantry. While some roads exist, the passages are so long and narrow that large mechanized formations could hold no power and could be stopped by said light infantry. Minefields and portable anti-tank missiles fired from the mountains would turn those narrow roads into congested vehicle graveyards. Both sides have thousands of ATGM launchers and tens of thousands of missiles. If either side actually wanted to make headway over the Himalayas, airlift would be the way to go, especially considering the initial location of troops for both sides. Indian army is mostly positioned alongside Pakistan, while Chinese forces are geared towards east. India has more troops closer to the Himalayan mountains than China. To fully utilize them, air mobility assets would be needed, but few helicopters can operate efficiently over such mountains. Initial helicopter air assaults would be fairly low in numbers and wouldn't venture far across the border. China has more helicopters that could be useful over the Himalayas. Airborne assaults would come as well. China in particular has a robust airborne corps. But airlift assets would also be needed to quickly haul light infantry units as reinforcements. A good deal of those flights would be theoretical only, as air superiority would also be needed to perform such airlift incursions. China has the upper hand in numbers and is roughly equal in average quality. But the initial disposition of forces favors India. Their air bases are fairly evenly spread out, while China has but a few bases in the west. Especially this part of the front would be severely lacking Chinese air support. India might enjoy several to one local air superiority in numbers for the first week or two. Chinese SAM units and ballistic missile units would also be in the wrong place, with great majority of both being near Chinese coastline. So the Chinese numerical edge in such systems would not fully come into effect until most of their short-range units are relocated. Still, even with just using longer-ranged missiles, Chinese could easily match total Indian arsenal. Their bomber aircraft would be especially helpful as delivery platforms. The reconnaissance edge is on the Chinese side. Satellites-wise, it's not really a contest, with China enjoying daily satellite revisit rates. Other Chinese recon assets are more numerous in theory, but again, it would take a week or so until enough of them are relocated closer to India. And all of those Chinese aircraft may not even find room, due to inhospitable Tibetan plateau and Taklimakan desert. Not only are military air bases scarce, but so are commercial airports. In-air refueling might help, but it's an area where neither side is particularly strong. Chinese tanker to combat plane ratio is especially poor. So small Indian incursions would happen all over the front, especially to the west. By the first week, China would use the commercial airports and achieve some balance of power. All those bases and airports could either be crowded and less efficient, or could house less planes and also be less of a target. Chinese would also be hindered by their pilots receiving less training on average. The battle on the ground would see very slow movement, with infantry having to traverse harsh terrain. Chinese theoretical massive edge in attack helicopters would be blunted both by lack of numbers locally and poor performance at such high altitudes. At the same time, SAM systems would also have it quite hard in such environment. Mountains would prevent long radar range, and heavy systems would be next to impossible to deploy by anything but road. it really would be mostly a war between regular infantrymen with fairly little heavy fire support. On the naval front, China is much more numerous. But the two navies actually meeting would not be an easy feat. Shortest route would be through Strait of Malacca. But world politics and no allies rule would make it very hard to actually use that route. Even if two belligerents somehow ignored the nations in the strait, it's still a choke point which would make it hard for China to utilize its numbers. India would know exactly where to look and shoot. Sunda Strait would not be much better. With Indonesia being the sole monitor there, chances of it going to war would also rise. Third option would be to go all around, avoiding straits. But that trip would be by far the longest. It would be hard on logistics. And upkeeping a fleet in a distant ocean is extremely taxing. Chinese could hope to sustain only a part of their fleet for up to 2 months in the Indian Ocean. Considering Indian Navy home turf advantage and ground-based aviation threat, such Chinese fleet would really have to stay far away from Indian shores in order to maintain a decent casualty ratio. Perhaps the biggest Chinese edge would be its nuclear submarine fleet. Being much more mobile than conventional subs, those would keep most of Indian anti-submarine assets busy. Supporting an amphibious assault on top of that would mean less support for the combat ships. Basically, no such projection of naval power would happen. India lacks strength to approach Chinese coast, and China lacks sustainment to keep enough fleet close to India. Trying to operate near India would yield greater losses for the Chinese. But in a hypothetical neutral sea battle, Indian Navy wouldn't really stand a chance, due to numbers and technology edge China enjoys. The war would thus see very modest Indian gains of Chinese territory, until Chinese build up their forces. Territory lost up to that point would not be of much economic importance, as it's mostly empty mountains. After a few months, the Chinese would bring enough forces and construct various makeshift bases. They would push back. They would wear out the Indian Air Force. Much bigger Chinese air assault and airborne corps would mean India could not match the mobility of Chinese on the front. Even though Chinese losses would be quite steep attacking in such mountainous territory, eventually they would regain all the territory and push a little into India. China may try to cut India in half here, but such a narrow piece of land would actually negate Chinese mobility advantage. And India can field just as many mountain infantry units as China can. Again, Himalayas are pretty wide. Using only infantry works there, but not in flatter areas. Actually crossing the mountains when Indian heavy hardware would be waiting in the plains would be insane, and thus likely not attempted. End result would see similar casualties on both sides, in air and on the ground. But given the size of Chinese air forces, their losses would account for a lesser portion of their total. With a few bits of Indian territory taken, and both sides lining hundreds of thousands of reservists near the mountain range, the front movement would come to a standstill. Within a limited time frame war, say 1 year, China could not utilize its massive industrial advantage. And in such conditions, the outcome of the war would be this: marginal Chinese victory. Thanks for watching! If you liked my video, subscribe to my channel. And if you really like my videos, you can even support my work via Patreon. Also, check out my website for polls, video suggestions, and my store, offering some cool t-shirts, mugs, and other stuff. And remember, Binkov may talk about hypothetical wars, but only real peace can bring us all together.